Welcome everyone to the Agile XXL Scaling Agile for Project Teams. My name is Alan Bustamante and I will be leading the session today. All right, so here's our agenda for today. First, we'll define scaling. Scaling is a big topic and we'll define it in the context of the webinar. Then we'll cover the three-pillar model as highlighted in the white paper of the same name as this webinar, Agile XXL. And then I'll share a few final thoughts on scaling Agile for project teams. All right, so whenever someone asks a question about whether something is Agile, I always like to reference back to the Agile Manifesto for my first source of guidance. So what does the Agile Manifesto say about scaling Agile teams? Well, quite simply, it says that the closest thing that it comes to saying anything about scaling Agile teams or Agile project teams is that the most efficient and effective method of conveying information to and within a development team is face-to-face conversation. It says nothing about, there's no prescriptive guidance there. It doesn't say anything about scaling not being possible, that it can't be done. Simply that face-to-face conversation is the best method of communication. So what do the thought leaders say? Well, Jeff Sutherland, who is one of the co-creators of Scrum with Ken Schwaber, he says that any team over 7 in size should be split up into multiple Scrums. Now, Jeff has done some research in growing Scrum teams, and there are some publications out there that he has published, and if you're interested in that, I can send that to you if you email me. I can send you some links. James Shore says 12 people turns out to be a natural limit for team collaboration. And Mike Cohn, who has written several books on Agile, says that the largest single Scrum team that I have worked with where I was content to leave them alone was 14 people. So clearly there is no agreement on ideal size. And the often talked about rule of thumb for an Agile team is 7 plus minus 2 people, or 5 to 9 people. Okay, so how do we define an enterprise Agile project team for this webinar? One, we define it as requiring 2 or more sub-teams. So a sub-team is basically just a component of a larger team and a larger project team. So in this case, we have a team made up of 20 team members broken out into 4 sub-teams. And this team has 1 or more team members non-co-located. So in this case, we have 2 sub-teams located in the U.S., 1 team in Europe, and 1 sub-team in India. So whatever sub-team size means to you, that would be up to the individual organization to decide. Okay, so the three-pillar model. So the three-pillar model covers 3 aspects of projects: people, process, and tools. And people, process, and tools is not something that's new, but what's new here is really the intersection points at which these 3 different parts of the project intersect. So we have inefficient team, disengaged team, and disorganized team. So if we look at the people policies, when they're not aligned with process and tools, we get a disengaged team. This results in lost productivity, misunderstandings, and the inability to self-organize. When process is not aligned, we have a disorganized team. And we need to make sure that when we have process, that the process is not overly burdensome. So as projects scale, some standards should be put in place. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. Then we have tools. When tools is not aligned with people and process, then we have an inefficient team. So what this affects is the team's ability to work optimally. You know, the communication structures and everything else that tools provide that they facilitate for the team. When all 3 of these things are aligned, then we have a true enterprise Agile project team. And this is a team that is functioning at an optimal level where they're communicating, they have processes that take into account the individual sub-team's needs, and they have these people policies that keep the teams engaged. All right, so let's take a look at people policies first. And when people policies are not aligned, issues with workspace, partnerships, and empowerment contribute to teams becoming disengaged. So why is a workspace configuration so important for large teams? And quite frankly, that's just because there's so much happening. And we know there's more story card updates, there's greater competition for meeting rooms. Teams are required to collaborate more with other teams, so we need to make sure that we break down silos. And in this example here is it's an example of a project team that I worked on about a year and a half ago, of the floor layout that we had for our team, which had over 100 folks on this team. And we had most people were co-located in Houston. We also had business folks in Canada, as well as Boise, Idaho. And then we had a testing team in India, which I'll talk a little bit about later. As you can see, as we walk clockwise around this image, we had space for schedules, burndowns, and other charts. We also had co-located project development, so teams could collaborate closely with one another. We had breakout rooms, which teams could schedule if they needed to have meetings. We had open spaces where these open spaces were not scheduled. They were just available to any team that needed to use them. They had a whiteboard there for whiteboarding, and if that space was available, then they were able to use it. Co-located production support. So as teams start to release earlier, because on Agile projects, right, we're delivering software more frequently, this software that goes out into production has to be supported even before the project ends. So co-located production support allowed the production support team and the project development team to collaborate closely. You can see that the low walls on the cubes facilitated that collaboration. So, you know, there was a hum across the floor, not a loud disturbing hum, but just the action, being able to monitor the progress of the team and what was going on with the project. Everything was very visible. So having that close collaboration amongst the different teams with the production support and the project development team made this environment very conducive to learning and to dealing with issues quickly. And then build and release management, obviously located on the same floor. We had other areas of this floor that we were developing the software in, but it's not visible here in the picture. So partnerships, another key component to having successful people policies. And not aligning partner or client provider people practices can leave team members from different organizations resenting one another. And that's one thing that we want to prevent. So there are three things that, to my mind, really we need to consider when considering partnerships. One is organizational culture. So are the employee empowerment, team evaluations, those kinds of things, those kinds of people policies, are those in place to make sure that we avoid a situation where one sub-team becomes jealous or competitive with another sub-team. Geographic culture. So this could be across cities, states, countries. Even here in the U.S., cultures are different from north to south and east to west. So we want to be mindful of the cultures of the partners that we take on. And an agile kinship. So does the organization that we're going to partner with, do they share an agile kinship with us, meaning that maybe they're not an agile shop now, but they have aspirations to be, and that's something that we can help them with. Or if we're an agile shop, can our partner help us? Or if we're not an agile shop, can our partner help us develop an agile shop? So we want to look at those kinds of things to make sure that we're working towards the same goal. Without a doubt, the right partner will help you ship code. All right, and the last thing as far as people processes is empowerment. So the Agile Manifesto says build projects around motivated individuals, give them the environment and support they need, and trust them to get the job done. So agile processes, especially scaled agile processes, require empowerment of the team, the sub-team, and the individual to deliver the best outcome. So when we talk about processes here in the next section, we'll cover that a little bit more depth. But we want to make sure that our team members on our team have the empowered ability to, as they say, stop the line, to have an effect, so that we keep them engaged and let them know that they have a say in what happens on the project. And this goes, if any of you have written Daniel Pink's book Drive, this goes along with what he talks about in that book is autonomy, mastery, and purpose, is allowing team members to get those three things in order to feel like they're being involved. All right, so process. When process is not aligned, we have a disorganized team, and the issues with planning, team coordination, and some team structure contribute to teams being disorganized. Before we get started on those three things, let's talk briefly about how traditional processes have been defined in the past. So, and this is still this is still the truth in many organizations today that I've been in, where we have a standard process group that dictates a process. So this is the process, and the process standards group could be it could be the PMO, or it could be a process engineering group. Many large organizations have a process engineering group that defines process for the organization. So I don't want to pick on the PMO, but process standard group could be any group within the organization that is charged with defining process for the organization. And traditionally, they define the process, and then it's up to the individual teams to execute this process. So as I have highlighted here, we have Team A, Team B, and Team C. These are independent individual teams. These are not sub-teams, as I had talked about before. So Team A could be a team of 5 people, Team B could be a team of 50 people, and Team C could be a team of 100 people. And no matter how large these teams are, whether they're scaled up in size or scaled out, distributed, they all must follow the same process. So what are the results of some of this this dictated process? Well, for one, it discourages ownership. So processes that are too centralized will foster distrust between the project team and the organization, because the people who are doing the work are not entrusted with the responsibility of how to do the work. So we want our team members to own the process, and they're not going to own it unless they feel like they're involved in creating it. Two, increases waste, right? So there's no feedback loop. Centralized processes create waste within the system, and the waste will increase exponentially as teams grow. So that waste includes wait times, additional documentation that needs to be done, or that is done that may not need to be done. And then inhibits innovation. So as unsexy as some of our applications may be, we still want our teams to innovate and create innovative solutions. So there's a really good book out there called The Wisdom of Crowds that talks about, it's by James Surowiecki, that talks about how if you take the brightest person from a team and you put them in a room to solve a problem by themselves, and you charge the team, the rest of the team, the responsibility to charge to come up with a solution for the problem, then the group will actually come up with the better solution over the smartest person. So again, we want to make sure that we're giving control back to the team to modify process so that they're able to innovate, because they understand better what's happening at the local level. And changing this will not be easy. So we have 30 plus years of muscle memory. Generations of management have been groomed this way. It's based off of Frederick Winslow's scientific management, and we see it here today as well. This image here is of an advertisement I saw. I spoke at Agile Prague several weeks back, and as I was coming out of the airport, it's a well-known consulting organization. If you're a fan of golf, you probably know their spokesperson. And a couple of problems that I have with this advertisement here. One is that it says, how do you get more out of the same resources? It poses that question. Well, projects are not delivered by resources. They're delivered by people. And if you've worked on software projects, you know that it's a creative endeavor. And it's knowledge work. So it's not the same as putting people on the factory. And then the second problem I have with this is the sheep. And you don't have to know a whole lot about animals to know that sheep are generally looked at as dumb animals. And so certainly we don't want to liken our project team members to sheep on a project. So this idea that dictating things down to a centralized process is going to take time to get over this hump. Again, we don't want this. So how should an agile process be defined? Well, first off, we want to start with involving the individual subteams and giving feedback to the project standards group. And project standards group does have a value, added value when it comes to agile projects, especially scaling agile projects. But each subteam has an evolving set of subteam practices that they use. And these kinds of things are things such as stand-up times, value metrics, definition of done, retrospectives, length and time of retrospectives. And that information is fed into their own process. But when we start talking about a project process, again, this is different from what I talked about earlier, which was the process, which was the process across all teams, all independent teams, regardless of size or distribution. In an agile process, we have a project process definition, which takes into account this unique project, this unique agile project, and what's going to work well for this project. So we have the subteams that are feeding information back up into this project standards group. And a project standards group is going to understand things like regulation, governance, compliance requirements. So some of you may be asking, well, you know, there has to be some oversight, right? Because team members may not understand what are the compliance requirements for the industry, such as the medical device industry. So those things do need to be considered, and that's where a project standards group will come into play. And then they will update the project process, which continuously evolves. So these things can be things like coding standards, and you know, test-driven development. Are we using TDD, naming conventions, refactoring, reporting structures, those kinds of things. And how frequently it's updated will be up to the team. So it's something that just needs to get monitored. There's no one right way, or you know, one right timing, if you will. Could be every week, every couple of weeks, and so on. So planning. Let's take a look at how planning can occur on a scaled team. So when I was on this project that I had talked about earlier, where I had showed the workspace, we were developing a commodities trading system, and the way we structured the planning, we had stakeholders that would populate a stakeholder request list, and our product owners would then meet to pull these stakeholder requests and discuss them, converse with the stakeholders, and negotiate trade-offs. And then they would prioritize that into a story map for the individual teams. As you can see here, we had this story map that was prioritized. And then the individual product owners would meet with their teams, their sub-teams, and populate those subteam product backlog. So as you can see here, have subteam, tax subteam, settlements, nominations, and so on. And each team, each subteam had their own product backlog that they would pull from. Now on this project, we ran 2-week iterations and delivered software every 5 iterations. So we were delivering software every 10 weeks. And every iteration, each team would pull the most valuable items from their backlog to be delivered in the next iteration. Very similar to how smaller teams operate. Team coordination. All right, so many of you might recognize this as a Scrum of Scrums. It's probably often the first, I would say, the first thing that gets tossed out there that whenever teams start talking about scaling. And while it does have value, it's not the only the only method out there for monitoring and managing progress on a scaled team, but it does warrant getting mentioned. So on this team that I worked on, we had a status council, and each sub-team had a representative from their team that would meet with this council, and this was done on a daily basis. And it did not have to be a product owner or an iteration lead or a scrum master. It could have been anyone on the team that just had time or wanted to go to this meeting. And during this meeting, we would update each other on the status of the subteams. So this was a very good method of keeping tabs on how the project was proceeding. And I was talking with a colleague the other day about this, and he actually has product owners get together to have their own product owner meeting to talk about status. So this could easily morph into other types of status meetings, but we want to be conscious of making sure that we're not having too many meetings and able to be successful with the work that needs to be done. So what should sub-team structures look like? There's three that I'm familiar with. Only one that I see that has worked in the past. The first is dividing teams up into components. So here we have teams broken out into a data layer and a UI layer. And it could be a business objects layer or anything else. And the problem with this is that when you have component teams, it creates tightly coupled dependency among the teams. So no one team can produce a full feature. And it increases waste due to additional handoffs. So when we break teams out by components, we don't really provide any value, especially if there's a delay in one team. The most frequent sub-team structure type that I've seen is testing and engineering. And breaking up by function. So here we have testing, engineering, teams. Again, we have the same problem where no team can deliver one piece of functionality. It's a waterfall phase-oriented mentality to sub-team formation. And for my PMPs, you recognize this as part of a matrix organization. Many matrix organizations are broken out this way. And the problem that I've seen with this on projects is that, you know, how do I make, you know, a testing team, for example, individuals broken out by function will look at it as how do I make testing look good versus how do I make the project team look good? So there's competing interests there. You know, all skills are present on the team, but not committed. So, and again, very important that no team can deliver its own, deliver a fully functional feature. So the best way that I've seen to be able to deliver an application on a scaled project team is to break teams out by feature team. So here we have two teams. One is the tax team, one is the settlements team. Each is responsible for delivering a feature set within their domain. So this is the best scenario. because teams can build an entire feature. And even if settlements doesn't deliver, tax can still deliver their functionality. And if they need data from settlements, they can mock that data. But it's not going to stop them from delivering their feature set for the iteration. All right. So here's a common Agile distributed model. And it's based on waterfall development. And the problem with this is that if you look at the team in the U.S., we have almost all the skills we need to deliver a full feature. We have requirements, architecture, engineering. We have automated integration testing. And then over in India, we have manual integration testing. And the problem becomes apparent when we start deploying code, because in an Agile team, we release code very frequently. So I can show you here, if we deploy a good build, and I'm just going to mention the Eastern Standard Time. I have this broken out in Eastern Standard Time and India Standard Time. To keep it simple, I'm just going to mention Eastern Standard Time. We deploy a good build at 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and the test team in India tests it. They report a defect at 11:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So here we have a 15 and a half hour lapse in time. Then we ask the team, so the defect gets fixed, and we ask the testing team over in India to verify the fix at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. There's 11 and a half hour time lapse. Team in India verifies the fix at 10:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, which is an 11 and a half hour time lapse. So the mean time to fix is 38.5 hours. Now, in a waterfall environment, this might make sense because testing is pushed to the end. But again, not for an Agile environment where testing is continuous. All right, so let's talk about a better Agile distributed model. And this is based on Agile development. So the idea here is to group teams such that each team has everything they need to deliver a feature. So this goes back to having a full feature team. And here, as you can see, we have requirements, architecture, engineering, automated integration testing, and manual integration testing. So what happens when we have a defect in a build? So assume we deploy a good build at 8 a.m., and then we report a defect at noon, verify the fix at 3 p.m., and then the fix is verified at 4 p.m., so total mean time to fix is 7 hours. So I know a lot of organizations that have not converted over to this way of delivering software, and oftentimes the reason cited is cost. But I can guarantee you, I don't have the numbers to back this up, but I can guarantee you that if you're a very cost focused organization, on paper, you might look at this and say, "Okay, well, test engineers are cheaper in low cost countries, so it must be cheaper overall for the development of the project." But if we can blend those rates, I think you will find that the value you get out of building complete teams in higher cost and lower cost areas will far outweigh the benefit or any benefit you might gain from sectioning off teams along functional lines in a distributed model. Okay, so tools and technology. When tools is not aligned with people and process, then we generally get an inefficient team. And issues that I've seen the most revolve around prioritization, code quality, and collaboration. These things in my mind, they're not the only things, but these things in my mind contribute to teams becoming inefficient more than others. So a bit about tools before we talk about those issues. You know, tools can be low tech, high touch. This is my team here at Seapine, Agile Services team, and we used to use a physical Kanban board. This can be used for large teams. If you're large and co-located, physical boards work really well. And so we call that low tech, high touch. But if your team becomes distributed, obviously the advantages of that face-to-face and being able to meet at a physical board diminish. So definitely want to keep that in mind. There's also high tech, high touch. And this is our Seapine task board. This is what the Agile Services team uses now to manage our workload. And obviously there are advantages to a digital tool, you know, automated reporting, easier record keeping, easier access to data within subteams. So as teams become more distributed and grow in size, right, there's going to be more information that needs to be managed, and software can help with that. But again, tools can be anything from the physical to spreadsheets to a more high-end development management tool. Prioritization. Okay, so as project teams scale up in size and across geographies, prioritizing the simplest features becomes exponentially more difficult. And if you've ever been on a team that has scaled in size up and out, you know, the more people you have on the team, the more stakeholders you have to manage, and the harder it becomes to manage those competing priorities. So even if you're a large team and you're not distributed and you're still using stickies, which is not a bad thing. Stickies are great because they're very visual, and it goes back to that having that high touch factor. When you've got a million stickies laying around, they can become very difficult to manage, and even within a software tool. And prioritizing that information becomes more difficult. So there are tools out there that can help to manage this prioritization process. And I've got a few books listed here that I recommend. I'm not going to go into detail into each of these, but Innovation Games is a good one. Game Storming, Back of the Napkin, Visual Meetings, and the Play Zone, which talks about Lego Serious Play. But the more popular thing now among Agile teams is actually the Lego Strategic Play. So I highly recommend checking that out. And a word about games. If games is a naughty word, as it often is, and especially in a large organization, use a different word. Use activity or exercise. But the studies have shown that when we take learning and we take these kinds of issues, such as prioritization, and we bring them into the physical world, using gaming, that the learning process is more valuable because we're exercising both sides of the brain. So highly encourage you to read some of these books. So here are some examples. So dot voting is one. This is the Agile Services team here. We are prioritizing a few things for something that we were working on. And we had over 20 items, and we were able to whittle those down to five or six in a matter of minutes. And the whole premise behind dot voting is basically everyone just gets a certain number of dots, and then they can use those dots however they like. They can put all dots on one item, or they can spread them out evenly. But ultimately, you're going to get some of the items getting flushed out because they'll either have no dots or they'll have too few dots. So it's a very good prioritizing way to prioritize items. The innovation games that I mentioned before, here's an example of pruning the product tree. I helped run a mayoral election with a team in Canada. We did this virtually, so you know, this is not something where somebody has to be in a room physically to participate. And essentially what we did is we brought in these mayoral candidates into these virtual chat rooms, and they were able to converse with their constituents. And we had four or five chat rooms ongoing at the same time, and there were several candidates. And the constituents would put these apples on a tree. And apples may be, you know, a skate park. They want a skate park, or they want a civic center, or they want, you know, a new clubhouse. And these kinds of things would be posted to the tree, and they would prioritize as appropriate. And the mayoral candidate could interact in real time with their constituents. So this helped them better understand their needs and help them shape their platform. And another example, I had mentioned Lego strategic play. So again, this is gaming, but you don't have to use the word gaming to get this put into your environment. If activity or exercise is a better word, then use it. In this example, I did not lead this session. This was a session that was led by another presenter at Agile Prague. And the team's job essentially was to build an airport. And so they were broken out into various sub-teams. So as you can see here in this image, they've got, there's probably about seven people on this team, on this sub-team. And there were other sub-teams, I'd say like four or five. So, you know, around 40 to 50 people collaborating to build an airport out of Legos. But each sub-team was responsible for building a different aspect of this airport. So this team here, the sub-team, responsible for building the flight tower or control tower. Another team was responsible for building the runway. Another team was responsible for building the fire truck. So whatever the product owner had decided that they wanted in their iteration, they would the sub-teams would work on. And this game was very useful for seeing how large teams can work together and apply these concepts, yet be separated from their day-to-day project work. And you know, let's face it, it's fun. So teams love fun. It's a great opportunity. You know, fun should not be expelled from the corporate workplace. Highly recommend engaging in these kinds of activities when scaling up a large team. Another issue that becomes a sticky thorn with growing project teams is code quality. So a five-person team is going to have less issues than a 100-person team in managing the code base and making sure that there's not a lot of waste or what we call technical debt going into the code base. So as project teams scale, the ability to keep technical debt low and create deployable builds quickly becomes challenging. And automation, for sure, is one of the best protections against poor code quality because it speeds up the feedback loops. Remember, Agile is all about getting quick feedback. And so we don't want that to diminish with large project teams. So whether a team is scaled up to 100 people, or they're scaling out, or they're becoming more distributed, we always want to make sure that we're ensuring code quality, because as that code base grows, then we want it to become as manageable as possible. So here in this example, we've got three teams, one in Houston, one in Santa Clara, one in Bucharest, Romania. And each of these engineers is going to, you know, they're going to TDD their code or test-driven development, unit test, run local integration builds, and make sure that those builds are running correctly before they redeposit their code into the source code repository. And here I have an example of how Seapine tools fit into that, into the strategy with our Surround SEM, which is our source code management tool. That source code repository is then updated, and we have a continuous integration server that pulls that repository for any changes. And when a change occurs, the CI server will grab those mainline changes and do a build. And it'll run test automated scripts against that build. And products such as our QA Wizard Pro, which helps with automated functional testing and load testing, will try to break that build. And if the build breaks, then it's a bad build, then the team gets notified. And there's various notification elements that can be used. You can use lights, or more common is just getting an email. But whatever happens, we want to make sure that the team knows it, and that they can jump on it. If it's a bad build, if it's a broken build, that they can jump on it quickly and make the necessary updates so that they can fix the build. If it's a good build, then we deploy that good build to a model office. Now some environments will deploy it to a production environment, but if you've still got some manual testing, which in my experience you can't get rid of all the manual testing, there's always the edge cases, deploying it to a model server, deploying that good build to a model server where manual testers can test the product is critical, and doing that through an automated mechanism can help your manual testers manually test that code as soon as it's ready. And of course, we recommend our own products, TestTrack TCM and TestTrack Pro for testing, doing manual testing. Then maximize collaboration. So there are many tools out there for maximizing collaboration, and I'm not going to go into detail on any one of these specifically, but obviously Instant Messenger and video conferencing, and now with the Android and iPhone devices, we can do FaceTime and all that good stuff. But these are going to become more essential for teams that become large and scaled. So as they become large and distributed across geographies, there's going to be a greater reliance on these technologies to enhance the collaboration among the team members. All right, so some final thoughts on scaling for Agile project teams. One is fight the urge to be pure Agile. So these are some scaling truths that I've seen. I usually, when I go to a conference, I like to ask people, so tell me about your Agile process. And I get the comment more often than I care to that, well, we're not pure Agile. And I like to ask, well, what does that mean to you? What does pure Agile mean? And a lot of times they talk about Scrum, but as hopefully many of you are well aware, Agile is more than Scrum. And there are many methods out there to choose from, and there are many practices, and we need to fight the urge to be pure Agile, to consider yourself or compare yourself to other people who may not be in your, other organizations that may not be in your industry. So again, put Agile in industry context. So what does Agile software development mean in your industry, right? Medical device industry is completely different from a web startup. You can't expect to be a medical device manufacturer to be as Agile as a five-person web startup. And being Agile is going to need to be put into industry context so you know that, are you more Agile than others in your industry? Not are you more Agile than everybody else on the planet. Put Agile in project business context or bigness context. So what we want to know is, how large is our team? As a team that is 100 people in size will not be as nimble as a 10-person team. a distributed team will not be as nimble as a co-located team. So if we've got a very, very large team, 100-person team, everybody's co-located, they're going to be more nimble than the 100-person distributed team. So again, put it in bigness context. And mute the zealots. You know, there's a lot of people out there that will, are not afraid to say, you know, that their Agile is better than your Agile. And, you know, many believe that if you're not shipping code every 2 weeks, something is wrong with you, and they'll try to convince you of that. And that might make you afraid to adopt Agile in your environment, adopt Agile practices. So don't be fooled by that. You know, going back to understanding industry context, you know, the fact may be that if you're in medical devices or another highly regulated industry, defense, whatever, you might be shipping code twice as fast as your competitor, which it makes you agile. And lastly, just focus on continuously improving the process, people's and the tools. So Agile is, you might have heard this said many times, Agile is not about the destination, it's more about the journey, and that is so true. So make sure that you're always continuously refining. This goes back to, you know, how do we define the right process for our project, right? Making sure that we're continuously looking at and questioning what it is we're doing about how we're, how are we managing people with people policies and our processes and tools. So always be questioning what we're doing and making sure that we have the best process out there, the best policies in place, I should say. And coaching. So coaching is also very important. If you're new to Agile or scaling projects for Agile teams, then bring in coaches and help develop your internal coaching ability. So coaches can help guide you across hurdles and help you make the mistakes that they have seen in the past, help not make the mistakes that they've seen in the past. And I've heard people describe it as, losing weight, where initially to develop the habits necessary for an Agile team or to lose weight, you need to develop those over time, and that needs to be coached in so you have the confidence and the ability to know that you're doing the right thing. So don't be afraid to bring on coaches to help you with your scaling endeavors. All right, so there is further reading. This presentation was actually based on our Agile XXL Scaling Agile for Project Teams ebook. That is downloadable from our website. If you'd like to get that and you can't find it on our website, please feel free to email me, and I'd be happy to send you the link. And that's it. Thank you very much.